Welcome. It's a word that has a long history in Christian worship, and especially in this last generation, we've worked especially hard to make our welcomes deeper and more meaningful. May the Lord widen our doors and expand our table to include all of God's children. Amen. Trucks carrying humanitarian aid have begun to roll into Gaza. May the Lord continue to smile on the diplomatic efforts to provide aid to those most vulnerable and helpless. Last Sunday evening, our sister in Christ, Sandy Eichmann, passed from this life into the arms of her eternal Father. Plans for a memorial service are still pending, and the God of comfort surrounding the Eichmann family with care and compassion. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship with this morning's prayer.
Pastor Mike.
Oh, I'm sorry, what else?
We offer gluten-free communion wafers. They don't look much like wafers, but they're little pieces of gluten-free bread. And they're in a colored paper cup. So if you're not gluten-sensitive or if you don't need the gluten-free, leave those for the folks who do. We have about four people, I think, usually. So, but sometimes you just reach for the paper cup that seems most near. And so if you just bring that to your attention. Is that okay? Everybody, does that make sense?
Yeah.
That makes sense? Okay. All right. Thank you for reminding me, Cindy. I didn't hear that.
I said you are gluten-free and you have issues and we need more colorful.
Okay, yeah. If we need more,
then let us know.
And the offer giver will gladly oblige. Everybody good?
Yeah.
Okay, good. All right. Give me a thumbs up. Thumbs up? All right.
That's good.
All right, there you go. You're on. Thank you.
Please turn with me in your bulletins to the order for confession and forgiveness. Rise as you are able. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete. Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow thee. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others. For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others and your creation, forgive us. For the ways we turn away from the you and our neighbor, forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. The hymn is number 526, God is here.
Thank you.
you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort and defend us, gracious Lord. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Okay. How did they do that?
They made one ton of metal, and so what they would do is they melt the metal, and then they had a little press they put into the soft metal that they make the image of.
Now, you're not a coin breaker. You're not a coin breaker. Are you a coin?
Of course not.
You're not a coin. But there's an image that's been impressed on you. You bear the image of God. Do you bear the image of God? You bear the image of God. Everybody here bears the image of God, which means that we belong to God. And if we belong to God, then we are free. God makes us. Free to be, not like Caesar's coin. Your God's coin means you're a free. Everybody good?
Yeah.
All right, I want a round of applause for Lynn. Thank you, man. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Lord. Y'all all good, okay? I'll see you in the nursery, okay? All right. Wayne Docker is going to read for us. Thanks.
The first reading is from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped to subdue nations. Before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and the gate shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen, I call you by your name. I serving you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know, from the rising of the sun and from the west, that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create love. I, the Lord, do all these things. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The same response simply to the Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord.
Bless the name of the Lord. Proclaim our salvation.
Declare God's glory among the nations and God's wonders among all peoples. For all the gods of the nations, they are but idols, but you, O Lord, have made the heavens.
And majesty and magnificence are in your presence, power and splendor are in your sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor and the glory. Bring offerings and intercourse to the Lord.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before the Lord, all the earth.
Hallowed out among the nations, the Lord's name, the one who made the world so firm that they cannot be moved, nor judge the peoples of heaven.
Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder, and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful, and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy at the coming of the Lord, for you come to judge the earth.
You will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with your truth. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your works of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and the Holy Spirit, and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only to Macedonia, but in Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak of that. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please rise for the gospel acclamation.
Live in Roman Palestine.
to establish the tax base. Once enrolled in the census, a tax would be levied on each person in each household, hence the phrase head tax. Now, for most of human history, taxes have been a hot button issue. Yes?
Yes.
But for the Jewish population of Judea and Galilee, the Roman head tax was particularly explosive. It was like a thumb in the eye of Jewish nationalists whose deepest, dearest dream was to establish Israel to the glory and splendor of King David. The head tax was Roman's way of saying, you're not in charge, we are. And by the way, the Romans were not elected or in any way democratically chosen to wield this authority. In the year 6 BC, there will not be a quiz, but just in case. In the year 6 BC, there was a controversy over who was to be the chief priest of the temple in Jerusalem. And to resolve this conflict, the Roman general Pompey, then in Egypt, was invited to Jerusalem. He came, but he brought with him thousands of Roman troops. Pretty soon they had control over all Palestine without even raising a sword. Roman taxation soon followed, and the head tax would be a major cause in the Jewish revolt that would lead to the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Like I said, there will be no quiz, just in case you want to. So, when the Pharisees and the Herodians asked Jesus to weigh in on the tax question, they're inviting him to walk into a minefield. It's interesting how they try to butter Jesus up, sweet talk him into falling into this trap. I'm reminded of how my kids, when they were teenagers, tried to hornswoggle me into paying for one of their escapades. They would say, dearest father, we know that you are sincere and teach the word of God in accordance with truth and show deference to no one, for you regard no one with partiality. To which I would say, yeah, how much? It always came down to how much. When Jesus' interrogators eventually dropped their bombshell question, is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? They are hoping that Jesus will incriminate himself. If he says, pay the tax, then they could say he's siding with the Romans and alienates, therefore, a good part of the Jewish population who might well then kill him. If on the other hand, he says not to pay the tax, he's effectively fomenting rebellion, something that will certainly get him killed. Rather than answer as these schemers expected, Jesus instead asked him to produce a coin. Where's my coin? Oh, here's the pocket. A coin! And Jesus then asked them, once they produce this coin, coin that was used to pay the head tax. By the way, you could, you had to use a Roman to pay the head tax. You couldn't use one of the other types of coins that were also in circulation. You had to have a Roman. So when they bring out this Roman coin, Jesus then asks whose image appeared on the face of the denarius. The denarius was like a day's wage. They answered the emperor. Which is interesting. These supposedly devout believers are walking around with a coin that has a graven image on it. That's a violation of the first commandment. But Jesus lets that pass. And instead famously responds, you know what he says, give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are good. Okay. The gospel reports that the Pharisees and the Herodians were amazed at Jesus' retort. And they went away, in a word, stumped. Let me play Mr. Rogers. Can you say stump? Stump. The problem for me, at least, is that Jesus' answer also leaves me and a lot of other preachers stumped. While this saying of Jesus is among the most memorable and frequently quoted, the question of what to render to Caesar and what to render to God continues to perplex many people. Right? There is a line between what is owed to God and what is owed to the governing authorities. But where exactly does that line lay? What exactly do we owe government? And what exactly do we owe God? Where are we supposed to draw the line between what Caesar demands and what God commands? If, as Scripture declares, we owe God everything, then is Jesus saying that we owe government nothing? If, on the other hand, rulers and leaders ultimately draw their authority from God, as Scripture declares, then is there anything we can deny or withhold from Scripture? Okay. Consider this moral question. Not legal, a moral question. Imagine someone who is a devout pacifist, who believes that all war is morally inexcusable. Does he or she have a right to refuse to render to Caesar any part of their taxes that go to funding wars or even preparing for war? I have a nephew who did that. I'll tell you later how that turned out. But imagine, on the other hand, someone who is a strong Second Amendment advocate who believes in their heart and soul that the right to bear arms should have no limitations whatsoever. Does that person have a right to withhold taxes from any agencies that would regulate or in any way inhibit the buying and selling of guns or other weapons? If you get that figured out, let me know, because I don't have an answer for that. Talk about stuff. I think it's important here to remember that in today's gospel, Jesus is not laying out a whole thought-out political philosophy. Either is Jesus laying out a theologically grounded theory of taxation. In the Gospels and in Scripture as a whole, there are, of course, many relevant texts that might inform such understandings. But if you're looking for God's holy plan for the way we are to exercise power and pay our taxes, then you're going to be stuck. God entrusts us to figure out the best ways for living together as a state, a nation, or a society. To that end, Jesus is saying in today's gospel, can't help. Can't resolve all. When Jesus asked his questioners to identify the image on the coin, perhaps Jesus is also inviting them to reflect on the image in which all people are created. In the very first chapter, the very first book of the Bible, the Word of God insists that we are created in the image of God. While our various currencies may be imprinted with the likeness of various revered leaders, George Washington, Queen Elizabeth, Nelson Mandela, we humans bear in our hearts and minds
reverence that image and we treat one another with respect and tolerance. So as we pay our taxes, local, state, and federal, we have a civic and moral duty to expect that the revenues will go toward honoring and defending the image of God in whom we are all created. We might even think of our taxes as God-pleasing when they go toward advancing health and safety. Not just of our citizens, but of all people who bear the image of God. This, I realize, is not an answer to all the questions we might have about rendering to Caesar and rendering to God, but it might be a good place to start a conversation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise for the hymn of the day. Is. Now clear is our location, ELW 58. Rise as you are.
Faithful God, whose Spirit stirs up the church throughout the world and binds believers near and far. Equip us for the work of faith and enlarge our hearts for the labor of love. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Creating God, the sea roars, the earth rejoices, and the heavens are glad at the wonder of all you have made. Bless the work of all those who safeguard the riches of creation. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign God, who rule in authority over the gospels, as you once worked through the womb of Cyrus for the good of your people, accomplish your purposes through the work of elected leaders and public servants. Guide them with your wisdom and compassion. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Caring God, your arms surround all who are lonely, oppressed, despairing, sick, and suffering. Pour out your abundant mercy on all whom this world has neglected, abandoned, and forgotten, including Chuck, Deanna, Marcia, Sandy, Adam, James, Christopher, Kara, Colleen, David, Renee and family, Paul, Joel, Andrew, Bill, Earl, Liam, Christine, Danny, Lorraine, Tammy, Carolyn, Julia, Elmore, Madeline, Barbara, Judy, Terry, Cliff, Harold, Arlene, Tom, Ryan, family and friends, Sandy and Michael, and our homebound family and friends, and those we name aloud or in our hearts. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, all our life belongs to you. When earthly idols threaten to lead your church astray, remind us that you alone are the source of our eternal hope. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Everlasting God, the saints of every age have sung your praise and shared your word. We give you thanks for the witness and pray that you may join them as citizens of your unending kingdom. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and amazing grace, through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
We share that peace with one another.
You may be seated as we receive our offering and hear this morning's choir.
rise for the offertory. Let the vineyards be fruitful.
We await his coming again to share with us the everlasting feast.
sustain us with this meal, strengthen us to serve all in hunger and want, and by this bread and cup make of us the body of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Christ goes with you.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
He's offered the same courtesy to me
but my LSU Tigers have lost.
The Phillies won.
The Phillies won.
Yeah. The Phillies won.
Ooh, that looks good right there. That is pretty good. Are they outside up right now? Are they 2-2?
One game.
There's one game left. Okay. Yeah. But in the ACFS, I don't follow that. All right, any further announcements? Didn't mean to stick the knife in there for sure. I'm sorry. Couldn't help it. It's so silly, isn't it, that we take these things so seriously. Okay. Receive the blessing of the Lord. May you rise. The God of glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names, and the Spirit who lives in